Hi, good morning, good afternoon, good evening. As always, happy whatever day it is you're watching this. Welcome to episode 75 of Left Side of the Aisle. This is for the week of, what is it, September 27th to October 6th, I think it is. And I'm your host. My name is Larry Erickson. And for the next, half hour or so, I'm going to be your ranter and raconteur, talking about things important to me, I think deserve your attention. As always, any reaction to the show can be sent to me directly. My email address is hoviating, W-H-O-V-I-A-T-I-N-G, at AOL.com. And if you didn't catch that, you can go to my website, Lotus Surviving a Dark Time, which will be up here somewhere a couple of times during the show, and you can get the email address from there. I do answer my email, so any comments are appreciated. Just be a little patient. I'm sometimes a little slow about it, but I do answer it. I ask only that when you send me email that you please include your cable show or Left Side of the Aisle or something like that in the subject line so that I know it's not spam. Also, this week is a little bit different because I'm actually not here. I'm actually doing this a week early because I'm on vacation, which is doubly odd since by the time you see it, I will be back. So I actually am here at the time I'm saying I'm not here. And if you understand that, drop me a line and explain it to me. Anyway, we got a couple of things to take care of here. First, we're going to start with our regular weekly feature, the Outrage of the Week. In June, there's this couple, Alvin and Pat Teosas. They own a modest home at a place called 29 Palms, California. It's about 200 miles east of Los Angeles in the California desert. And in June, they came home one day to find that their house had been foreclosed on. Contractors hired by the mortgage company, Wells Fargo, had broken into the house to secure it against damage and had removed all the couple's belongings, including Alvin's late parents' belongings from the house. There's one problem here. There was no mortgage on the house. There never had been. Alvin, in fact, he's a retired Mason, and as a teenager, he built the house with his father. Wells Fargo was, of course, very sorry for this mistake. Not sorry enough, it seems, to keep another contractor Wells Fargo hired from going back to the same house over the Labor Day weekend and again breaking in, taking out all the belongings and changing all the locks in the house. And the thing is, this is not an isolated instance. The Huffington Post recently reported a little while back on the case of Nancy Cox of Clawson, Michigan. She came home one day to find her possessions in the front yard smashed with a sledgehammer and a chalk drawing of a clown face on her garage with the line, another job well done. They report in the case of Kenneth and Margaret Karp of Pittsburgh, who came home and found the locks changed and found china damaged, photos of their daughter damaged, and a coin collection and the family cat missing. They also mentioned the case of Alan Danforth of Kansas City, who discovered his elderly parents' furnishings, their tables, their chairs, their heirlooms, everything, gone. The contractors involved in these cases, they are known as property inspectors or property preservers. Their job is to secure abandoned properties, unoccupied properties, against damage so that the banks that are foreclosing on them can get a better price for them when they go to auction. But all too often, as these contractors get paid by the amount of work that they do, they just ignore signs of occupation and just break in, take out all of the contents, which often just disappears somewhere, and put new locks on the doors. This is so common that a man named Richard Fursch, he's the sergeant in charge of foreclosures in the sheriff's office of Allegheny County, Pennsylvania. He says he gets about one complaint a week from homeowners who have come home to find their locks changed. A review of court records by the Huffington Post shows that there are 50 homeowner lawsuits against banks and these property management contractors over issues of break-ins of occupied homes. And consumer lawyers say that these cases represent just a small fraction of what's going on nationwide. What doubles the outrage here is that the Inspector General for the Federal Housing Financing Agency, this is the agency that actually oversees Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. This agency is reportedly raising, they say, all kinds of red flags about how Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac are failing to exercise any oversight on the contractor companies that they hire. But despite all the complaints, despite all the red flags, the regulators have actually done nothing. Now, quite bluntly, I think we know why that happens, but doesn't change the fact that it's an outrage. Are we going to move on from there to our, what's become our regular weekly feature, the Clarabell Award? This is for acts of meritorious stupidity. And it, I'm doing it right now because the clowns of the week, the dishonorees of the week, are Wells Fargo. The first time a contractor went to the home of Alvin and Pat Tiosas and wrongfully broke in, removed their belongings, and changed the locks, Wells Fargo was really, really sorry. It issued a statement, I'm quoting, "We are deeply sorry for the very personal losses that Tiosas family suffered as a result of their home being mistakenly secured and entered by a contractor hired to address a different nearby property. We moved quickly and have been in contact with the Tiosas family to resolve this unfortunate situation and right this wrong." After the second time it happened, Wells Fargo was really, really, really sorry. This is the statement. We are, quoting again, "We are deeply sorry for the very personal losses that the Tiosas family suffered as a result of their home being mistakenly secured. We are moving quickly to reach out to the family to resolve this unfortunate situation in an attempt to right this wrong." These people are such idiots and apparently screw up so often on such a regular basis that they have canned apologies. Wells Fargo, you are an evil clown, but you're still a clown. All right, something else. Now, I mentioned last week that, or 2 weeks ago, that the first anniversary of Occupy Wall Street was coming up. I wanted to talk some about that last week, but there was just too much stuff. I just didn't have enough time. So I figured I'd do it now. Because the first anniversary of Occupy Wall Street on September 17th, it was marked with demonstrations, marches, teach-ins, rallies, all kind of events. Here's the question. Did you hear about any of them? Now, yeah, maybe you heard about the one in New York City, but did you hear about any others? Now, I talked a couple of weeks ago about the idea of how you crush a movement, how the Occupy movement was crushed. And I said, the way you do that in this day and age is not by arresting everybody or whatever. You do it by making the movement invisible. If September 17th was any indication, the empire must be very, very proud of itself at how effectively it's crushed Occupy. Because, yes, there were demonstrations in New York City. About 1,000 people took part. And about 150 were arrested amid the now routine thuggery of the New York Police Department during a civil disobedience action that was looking to, you know, shut down the New York Stock Exchange. Several papers covered that. New York City, yeah, they covered that. But there were hundreds of Occupy protesters in the streets of San Francisco. And I found news about that only in the San Francisco Chronicle and a local radio station. And even then, while the article talked about the celebratory nature of the march, that was the celebratory nature, they said, the headline of the article was "Occupy Protesters Snarl Traffic." Occupy Seattle turned out about 100 people for a march, news of which appeared only in the Seattle Times and other local Seattle area media. The Detroit Free Press was one of the only outlets I could find that actually even mentioned the fact that there were plans for observations of the anniversary in 30 cities in the U.S. and around the world. In fact, I had to go to Business Week, of all places. I had to go to Business Week to be told that Asheville, North Carolina, Hilo, Hawaii, and Oakland, California were among the places where actions were planned. And in fact, the Business Week article was the only one I found that referred to the calls for a day of no work, no school, no banking, no shopping that were being raised in Toronto, Barcelona, London, Kuala Lumpur, and Sydney, Australia. I mean, yes, there is coverage of the San Francisco action in San Francisco. Yes, there is coverage of the Seattle action in Seattle. And again, as I said 2 weeks ago, this is how you crush a movement. You do it by breaking it into little fragments, all series of little local fragments, so that there's no connection, no sense of a connection to anything bigger, and so it becomes essentially invisible to the people, to the nation as a whole. And at the end of the day, by the way, at the end of the day, on September 17th, there were cases of the avuncular advice. It was the same old, urging Occupy to get into real political action, which seems exclusively to support electing liberal Democrats. In other words, Occupy was being advised to get into real action. The same old tactics, the same old strategies that have failed so spectacularly over the past four decades. That's what's being said. Yeah, the empire must be very proud of itself. All right, one last thing I want to bring you up on here in this part of the show. I won't go into a lot of detail about this. This is sort of like, I expect I'll be talking more about it over time, but I want to give you a heads up about it. Because when I do come back to it in the future, I want you to have some idea of what I'm talking about. This is about something called the Trans-Pacific Partnership, or the TPP. It's being negotiated between the United States and eight Pacific Rim nations. And it's being claimed to be, it's one of those, oh, you know, it's just another one of those boring trade deal thingies. You know, you just be bored by it. Nothing to see here. Move along. Go back to watching the Kardashians or whatever. But the thing is, this is being negotiated in such extreme secrecy that some members of the Senate cannot see the negotiating papers. And it's being done with almost no media attention. In fact, this has been done in such extreme secrecy and with such little attention that it recently had the 13th round of negotiations, and I doubt you have ever even heard of it. TPP has been called quite rightly NAFTA on steroids. For example, a text of the TPP chapter of the proposed deal, a text of the investment chapter, which was leaked back in June, revealed that U.S. negotiators are pushing to include NAFTA's notorious corporate tribunals as part of this new agreement. Tribunals which have been used to attack domestic laws in a number of countries. These tribunals are actually called investor-state dispute resolution. And what they do is they empower governments to sue corporations outside of the normal court system in these private tribunals. And they can sue over any action that they think any government is taking that might hurt their future profits that they hope to get under the treaty. These panels these complaints are heard by panels of lawyers from the private sector, three judge panels. The lawyers in these cases rotate between being the judges in these cases, who are empowered to impose fines, unlimited fines, on national governments on behalf of corporations, and representing the corporations that are bringing the suits against the national governments. Under the Trans-Pacific Partnership, all countries that are part of the pact would be obliged to conform their domestic laws, their domestic regulations, to the requirements of the TPP, the rules of the TPP, which are consciously designed to serve the purposes of corporations engaging in international trade. That's what the whole thing is about. Put more bluntly, Nations would be legally obliged to conform their domestic laws to the needs of transnational corporations. How far does this go? Well, all right. Proposed provisions include new investor safeguards. This would include making it easier to outsource and offshore jobs, to make it easier for them to assert control over natural resources. These proposed regulations would also severely limit the regulation of that any national government could impose on areas like financial services, land use, food safety, natural resources, energy, tobacco, healthcare, more. Sweat-free agreements, human rights agreements, environmental conditions that are sometimes placed on government contracts could be challenged in these secret tribunals. Buy local procurement policies that are intended to promote local economies, they would be banned. Now, there is some pushback against this. Australia doesn't like this tribunal system the U.S. wants to have. New Zealand is objecting to provisions that would take over its medicine pricing practices. New Zealand has these regulations that keep medicines cheap in New Zealand. This would get rid of them, and New Zealand's objecting to that. Every country involved, other than the U.S., has rejected the U.S.'s proposal to extend drug patent monopolies. Many of them have also objected to U.S. proposal that would forbid countries from using capital controls, taxes, and other such measures in order to control financial speculation. The pushback has been enough that this is not yet a done deal. The hope had been to get it done this year, but it's not a done deal. So we do have some time to try to deal with this. Because the thing is, this pact is an attack on our ability as citizens to have a say in our economy and over the regulations having to do with health, worker safety, the environment, and other things. Personally, I really wish that this was not called the Trans-Pacific Partnership, but rather the Trans-Pacific Trade Partnership, because then it would be the TPTP, or TP twice over, and we know what TP is often full of. We are taking a break. Hi, we are back. The rest of the show, I'm going to do something I've been meaning to do for a while. The whole rest of the show is going to be our occasional feature and another thing. And this is where we talk about stuff that is not political. Usually it's some cool science stuff. And I got a bunch of different science stuff here that I was going to talk about for the rest of the show. The first one has to do with space exploration. Because a few weeks ago marked a couple of significant anniversaries in space exploration. It was the 35th anniversaries of the launches of the Voyager spacecraft back in 1977. August 20th was the anniversary of the launch of Voyager 2. September 5th was the anniversary of Voyager 1. And yes, those dates are correct. Voyager 2 was launched first. They numbered the craft that way because the different trajectories they were going to take through space, Voyager 1 was going to pass Voyager 2 and so get to the initial goal, which was doing flybys of Jupiter and Saturn. It was going to get there first. So that's why they were numbered that way. They carried on that mission. These two spacecraft carried on that mission with computers with 8,000 words of memory and 8-track tape machines. But, you know, despite the limitations, what now would seem incredible, it was cutting edge at the time, but now it seems incredible limitations. But the fact is, they sent back data on Jupiter's big red spot on Saturn's rings. They discovered erupting volcanoes on Io, a moon of Jupiter. They discovered hints of an ocean beneath another Jupiter moon, Europa. They found signs of methane rain on Titan, which is a moon of Saturn. Voyager 2 then went on to fly past Uranus and Neptune. It is the only spacecraft still to have done that. And then the two just kept on going and kept on sending back data. Voyager 1 is now about 11 billion miles from the sun. That's four times further than Neptune. It is well beyond the solar system. It is twice as far as the Kuiper Belt. Voyager 2 is not all that far behind. It's at about 9 billion miles from the sun. And now the two craft are about to make history again. They are about to become the first human-made objects ever to enter the actual void of interstellar space. The heliosphere is this giant bubble of charged particles that the sun blows around itself and actually serves to shield the solar system from the most intense cosmic rays. The heliosheath, which is where the Voyagers are now, is the outer layer of the heliosphere. It is the boundary between the area of space affected by the sun and true interstellar space. The heliosphere is thought to extend out to somewhere between 11 and 14 billion miles from the sun, which means Voyager 1 is now pushing right against the limit. It could cross over into true interstellar space literally any day. Now, bear in mind that the heliosphere could still be like another 3 billion miles further out. And even though Voyager 1 travels a million miles a day, 3 billion miles is still 3,000 days, which is something over 8 years. But the fact is, when you've been waiting for something for over 35 years, I guess that now doesn't seem that much longer. The two Voyagers have enough electrical power to last until 2020. After that, conservation efforts are thought they'll be able to keep at least some instruments going until about 2025. When the last instruments are shut down around 2025, Voyager 1 and Voyager 2 will have been sending back data for 48 years. After that, after they're turned off, they will take up a, if you will, a position of honor, and they will orbit the center of the galaxy essentially forever. Okay, moving on from there to some good news on the energy front. A solar energy group announced earlier this month that the U.S. is on track to install as much photovoltaic solar power this year as we did in the previous 10. The report is by GTM Research and the Solar Energy Industries Association, and it found that the U.S. installed twice as much solar power capacity in the second quarter of 2012 as it did in the same period in 2011. It added 742 megawatts of capacity. This growth, in fact, has been driven largely by some new utility is the word I'm looking for. Utility scale projects. In other words, this is stuff that, you know, it's not just people's houses or something. This is actually utilities that are building these and being able to provide electricity through solar power. And some of these have been using Department of Energy loan guarantees. The U.S. now has enough installed solar power to deal with a million homes. And it's not just solar. The wind industry has seen tremendous growth in recent years. Not long ago, the estimates were that the United States could have 40 gigawatts of installed wind power by the year 2030. There is today 50 gigawatts of installed wind power, 25% more 18 years earlier. The Department of Energy estimates now that wind energy could provide 20% of U.S. electricity by the year 2030, and that's like twice as much as nuclear power. This boom is due in part to a federal tax credit, a production tax credit. But the thing is, unless Congress acts, that that tax credit is going to expire at the end of this year. It'll be interesting to see how that that plays out, because it'll be a good metric for judging just how concerned our supposed liberals are with things like renewable energy, the environment, climate change, and so on, and just how concerned our conservatives are with actually aiding businesses. Okay, from there, I got some cool archaeology stuff, some cool archaeological discoveries recently. This guy, Colin Steer, he lives in Plymouth, in Devonshire, in the United Kingdom. And he's been living in this house for almost 30 years. And under the sofa, there is a dip in the living room floor, and he always wanted to find out what caused it. And when he retired, he decided he was going to find out. So he moved things around and started digging through the floor and discovered that the indentation in the floor was covering a well 30 inches wide, 33 feet deep, that dates to the 16th century. The well may be connected to something called Drake's Leat. This is a water course that was built in the 16th century by Sir Francis Drake to bring carry water from Dartmoor to Plymouth. Now, Steer is trying to find someone who can date the well more exactly, but in the meantime, he's got a cool little feature of his house. All right, speaking of old English stuff, one of the enduring mysteries of English history has been the burial place of King Richard III. It's known he was killed during the Battle of Bosworth Field in 1485, and after the battle, his body was stripped naked and paraded through the streets of Leicester to prove that he was dead. Researchers believe that he was buried in a nearby Franciscan friary, but the friary was demolished in 1530, and 1530s during Henry VIII's dissolution of the monasteries. So no one quite knew where the friary was. Guess what? They just found it under a car parking lot in Leicester. They found medieval window tracery, glazed floor tile fragments, part of what may be the cloisters, and a section of wall. And just over a week ago, they announced they have found human remains there, for which they say there is strong circumstantial evidence that this actually is the body of Richard III. So if DNA testing confirms that, there's another history mystery solved. Finally, and this is cool, researchers have used new techniques to examine 4,000-year-old implements found in Syria to reveal trade and trade routes of 4 millennia ago. These tools are made of obsidian. Obsidian is a natural occurring volcanic glass. It is very hard, and when you fracture it, it actually makes a blade sharper than a surgical scalpel. It was very highly prized for making tools. In fact, it's still used in some specialized surgical techniques. They use the fact that this is volcanic glass, and every volcano has a unique chemical signature. And they were actually able to determine from where these bits of obsidian came. Some of them were from an area where archaeologists already thought that there was a trade about 125 miles away. The other ones, however, they found ones that were from as much as three times that far away, indicating the trade routes are actually a lot more expanded than they thought they were. What's amazing here, and amazing to me, frankly, is not only was the team, using these chemical signatures, not only could the team identify what volcano it came from, they were able to tell which side of the volcano it came from. And that, to me, is just amazing. Anyway, I'm out of time. We got to go. You have the best week you possibly can, and I will see you next week with hopefully some more cool stuff. All right, bye.